get on your feet and welcome Kevin Johnson, Pastor Kevin, in the house today. Please. Come on. Honor the man of God. Bless you, man of God. Bless you, man of God. I love you too. Bless you. Yes, sir. Bless you. Bless you. Hallelujah.
Can y'all hear me? Amen. Amen. It is an honor to be here. It really is an honor to be here. And before I go ahead and make Satan even more angry by reading and preaching, I do want to say this. I said it the first service, and I'm going to say it again. Pastor, stand upon your feet. A shepherd carries a staff. I don't know how many of y'all may have been here in the first service, and I'm going to say it again if you missed it. A shepherd has to carry a staff because wolves seek to get in and kill the flock. Being a shepherd comes with a great sacrifice, a great cost, because the shepherd must be willing to lay his life down at any moment for the flock. And that staff is not for just gently guiding the flock along. Sometimes he has to take that staff and absolutely obliterate the wolf. He has to become very violent, and he has to become very intolerant when the deceiver seeks to get in to disrupt and dismantle what God has established in the flock. And so I have him stand up because I want you to understand, I know that he is taking this call very serious. And what you are blessed with is someone that it doesn't matter what season your life is in, if he has to lay his life down for you, he will without question. And so will you stand and give him some honor because of the mantle on his life? Amen. 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 You can be seated in the presence of the Lord. Now let me go ahead and really anger some more demons. I entitled this message, Kingdom Power. Somebody say it.
Kingdom Power.
Y'all ain't talking to me. Say it.
Kingdom
Power. Y'all still ain't talking to me. Say it.
Kingdom Power.
There we go. There we go. And the subtitle is Be Accountable, Be Productive, Be Powerful. The enemy has no new tricks. I'm going to let that sink in. He has no new tricks. When he was trying to dismantle the plan of God, when Jesus was in the wilderness, he actually tried to use the word to trip up the word. And so it's the same tactic. You witnessed it this morning. When the enemy tried to use someone to use the word to trip up the word. And so what I say to Satan is this: you lost again. God will not be mocked. And his word will never return to him void, incomplete. And you know when you're doing it right, because the enemy will have to turn it up a notch just to try to invoke fear into the hearts of the people in which God has said, I have singled you out today. Because now I'm about to elevate you and multiply my work through you. So I just wanted to go ahead and address that the deceiver took a loss again.
Right. Amen.
Amen. I'm going to read to you from the book of Romans, chapter 14, verse 12. This is the Amplified. It says, and so each of us shall give an account of himself, give an answer in reference to judgment to God. I'm going to read it one more time.
Because we're talking about be accountable. Somebody say it. Be accountable. And so each of us shall give an account of himself, give an answer in reference to judgment to God. Do you realize that everything that you do, everything that you say, every thought that you let go on unchecked is going to have to stand in judgment to God? And so we have to get to the place where we recognize that we have been given the responsibility of accountability.
Amen.
And that there are no exceptions. God is not going to look at you and I and wink at us like, oh, it's okay, baby. I understand. You slipped up again. It's all right. I got you under the blood. No, God is not going to look at the born-again believer and say, it's okay that you keep slipping up and messing up. Salvation's free, but the word of God requires accountability.
Amen.
And that means that we are responsible for receiving, accepting, and embracing the instruction of the Lord and saying, I will subject myself to the accountability of what you've established.
Amen. Amen.
So that means I have to let go of all of my excuses and grow up. Look at your neighbor, say, grow up.
Grow up.
Oh, you ain't look at me, look at your neighbor, say, grow up. That's right, that's right, that's right. Let's keep moving. Colossians chapter 3:23, and Pastor, I didn't realize this was in your office on your wall.
Amen.
Whatever may be your task, work at it heartily from the soul as something done for the Lord and not for men.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. We kind of got lost right here at this point last service. I'm going to read it again. Whatever may be your task, work at it heartily from the soul as something done for the Lord and not for men. Everybody hold up your Bible or your cell phone or your tablet. Do you realize what you're holding is our Constitution?
That's right.
It's not a religious doctrine that you're holding up. You can put your hands down, put the Bibles down. It is our Constitution, and you have to have a mind shift from just merely saying, oh, I'm just going to Bible study. No, you're going to Constitution study. Because we must be educated in what our rights and our privileges are. And this is our Constitution for living.
Kingdom civics
all the way. And what I love about our Constitution is that God puts clauses in the Constitution that address where we malfunction. This particular scripture, when it says, whatever may be your task, work at it heartily from the soul as something done for the Lord and not for men. I love that last part, something done for the Lord and not for men. He put that in because he knew that we had some jacked up motives. He knew that we had a tendency to want to take credit for something that we should never take credit for. Namely, God's glory. I'm going to dive right into this thing right here. Who in here, it's a rhetorical question, but just raise your hand just to entertain it. Who in here is familiar with the word glory? Who in here really understands what glory means beyond a religious context? Glory is not a religious word. It's a legal word. Glory is a legal word. Glory can be equated to potential. Everybody in here has heard of potential. Potential is what could be, but is not yet. That's potential. If I walked around this room right now, hold your hand out. What's your name, brother?
Rick.
Rick, it's nice to meet you. You're handsome. Hold your hand out. Put this in your hand.
All right,
I have an apple seed in my hand. What do I have? Y'all ain't talking to me.
Baby tree.
Apple seed. I put the seed in Rick's hand. I'm going to ask him, what did I just put in your hand?
A baby tree.
I love the answer because he's right. Now, here's what we struggle with. We don't understand the power of glory because what he's actually holding, what Rick you're holding in your hand, is the full weight of glory. Even though the seed looks like it's small and insignificant, like there's not much to it, but you're actually holding the full weight of the glory of that seed. The full weight of the glory of the seed is the apple orchard, packed in one seed. And when you really have a chance to admire the glory of that apple seed, what you're looking at is not the seed in form. You're actually looking at an orchard as far as the eye can see. You're seeing the manifestation. You're seeing the glory of the seed. And what happens is when we actually are called to work as unto the Lord and not to man, we feel like we got to get patted on the back for our sweat, for our labor, for our sacrifices. And we begin to come up with all these reasons. I deserve this. I deserve that. They overlooked me here. They overlooked me there. And we get lazy and we begin to get lackadaisical to the point where we're barely really putting in the work and the effort and the energy for thus said given task. And the Bible's telling us, look, when you are working, don't work like you're trying to win the approval of man. Work as unto the Lord. What that does is it protects your heart from having a selfish motive. And then in that place, hear me, in that place, when you guard your heart against selfish motive, trying to take some recognition that you don't need to have, you're actually setting yourself up for God to manifest your glory.
My God, let me keep moving. Let me keep moving. You know we can go some places, but I'm going to keep moving. Next point. Acts chapter 1, verse 8.
But you shall receive power. Somebody shout power.
Power. Mm.
Ability, efficiency, and might when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends, the very bounds of the earth. I love that. We just got done talking about glory a little bit. Glory is something that is actually always hidden in a container. Oh, this. And God's the one that established glory. He established the container. God always had glory in a container. This scripture says, you shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends, the very bounds of the earth. Why is this scripture so important? Because theologically, if you wanted to get into a debate, you could say, well, he was only talking to the people at that specific time, and that scripture needs to remain in that context. It doesn't mean that it's necessarily applicable to us today, because you got to keep it in context. Okay, that sounds like an educated thing, but because God always puts something in the Constitution that is a clause that supersedes man's limited understanding, he said this thing... this power, this person is not only going to be applicable to those people at that time. He said, I'll put this in there. This is going to go on to the ends of the earth.
Yes.
What does that mean? He said, what you don't understand is I've already prepared a certain type of people for a certain generation that's already packed with everything that they need that will manifest my glory at the appointed time. Amen. What we need to recognize is when we got born again, when we got born again, God said, now it's time to activate what I already put in them before they were formed in their mother's womb.
Come on.
When you're in a place where you see something that is glorious, something that is majestic, something that is beautiful, it's only because that thing was once hidden. And all of a sudden, there was an appointed time where that which you deem as glorious and beautiful, it came out of the shell or the place it was hidden. Do you realize that when you as a son or daughter of God, when you got born again, he said, the reason why I call it born again is because I had to reintroduce you to you. And what you didn't know about you is that you had the wrong idea about your image, about your likeness. Oh, we're going to unpack that. Let me get a drink. Genesis 1:26 says, let us make man in our image and likeness. And let them, somebody shout, let them. He said, and let them have dominion over the earth, I'm paraphrasing, and all of its resources. What's beautiful about that is that what God started before sin kicked in never left. I'm pausing because you got to think about that. Just because sin was activated didn't mean what God had already prepared became non-existent.
Yes.
Fallen man was still made in the image and likeness of God. Amen. The container. That which God prepared. Matter of fact, let's put some Bible on it. It says, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, nor has it entered into the imagination of man the things that the Lord has prepared. Somebody shout prepared.
Prepare.
The things that the Lord has prepared for those who love him. Yeah. We couldn't love God until we understood he loved us first. How is that possible? We're going to get right back to that point. It's because the Bible says they that worship God must worship him in spirit and in truth. And the last time I read the Bible, it says that God doesn't have love because God is love. And since God is love, and the Bible says that they that worship God in spirit and in truth, my God, that means if I'm made in his image and likeness, and if he breathed his breath in me from the beginning, then that which God is, I am. And since God is love and I am spirit and he is spirit, that means that what he put in me has the ability to change everything. So when we begin to examine the scriptures in its proper context and God's original idea,
hallelujah.
I don't want to get ahead of myself. We got to lay the content. Let me back up. You're moving too fast. Let's go. Here we go. Got to lay this thing out right. We're going. Okay, it's not about. I'm not going to read this, but I am going to get this in this half. I got about, 20 minutes? Okay. Okay, here we go. We're going to Colossians chapter 1, and I'm jumping into verse 9. For this reason, since the day we heard about it, we have not stopped praying for you, asking specifically that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritual wisdom, with insight into his purposes and in understanding of spiritual things. You got to pay attention to this prayer. You got to pay attention to this prayer because this thing echoes all the way through until the last human being will be born on this planet. That's how powerful this prayer is. Let's try to just touch that real quick. I'll read it again. For this reason, since the day we heard about it, we have not stopped praying for you, asking specifically that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritual wisdom, with insight into his purposes and in understanding of spiritual things. Notice it's talking about being filled with all the wisdom and spiritual knowledge. Question, is God spirit? Question, do you have a spirit? No.
We are.
Some people remember now. Some people remember. Come on. No, you do not. And this is where I got to draw the line. You got to have a new mindset about how you see yourself. If you're walking around with a mindset thinking you have a spirit, you don't fully understand who you are yet.
That's
You cannot have what you are because you are what you are. I have this jacket. That doesn't mean this jacket is me. If I have the mindset that I merely have things, that means that subconsciously I'm aware I could lose things. If I have the mindset that, oh, I have this, I have my car, I have my house, I have my kids, I have my wife. But we all know those things can go away. People can go away. So they're not you. But what you are, you can never lose. You don't have a spirit because you are a spirit. The Bible says in Genesis chapter 2, when God formed Adam from the dust of the ground, and he's standing there like this, is he alive yet? He comes alive when that which God is enters into his nostrils. The ruach, the very breath, the life source of what God is enters into the container, the vessel. Question, when God's spirit went into that vessel, could you say that that's a type of glory hidden in a container? Oh, here we go. And so when you begin to understand that God always prepares a place, what did God do? God started the principle of preparation from the beginning. Why did God create the planet? Because he thought about us. Oh, let me expand your mind. God doesn't just do stuff just to do stuff. God has a purpose for everything that he does. Amen. God actually had this idea about a human race. He got excited within himself and began to talk about this idea within himself and to the host in heaven. And he was so motivated, he said, I want to make this planet called Earth. Because if it's going to be a new race, a new species called the human race, and I love this because this dispels racism. God never said it's going to be the black, white, Orient, Hispanic race. He said it's called mankind, the human race. Amen. That's Bible. Amen. We can appreciate the diversity in the tones of our skin and the different cultures that we come from. But baby, when you get the revelation of the kingdom, you recognize God's kingdom is so big, he had to be created. So here we are. He's got these containers in the beginning, and he said, I'm paraphrasing, I'm gonna put myself in this container and it's hidden. For the purpose of the free will of this new species to make what heaven looks like manifest in a physical realm called Earth. Oh boy. My God. Let's keep going. Move forward. Verse 10. So that you will walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, displaying admirable character, moral courage, and personal integrity to fully please him in all things, bearing fruit in every good work and steadily growing in the knowledge of God with deeper faith, clearer insight, and fervent love for his precepts. Who was in the first service? Okay, don't say nothing. Who knows, other than the people that heard me earlier, what a precept is? Who in here has heard of a concept? Raise your hand if you've heard of a concept. A concept is an idea. If you look up the definition, it's going to tell you a concept is an idea. If a concept is an idea, then what the heck is a precept? That means a before idea. Oh, my God.
Pre means before. So here we are. The Bible's pointing out God has precepts. Matter of fact, there's another passage in the Bible that talks about, you know, loving God's word so much that we begin to study it line upon line, precept upon precept. In other words, God is saying, look, what you don't understand is because of sin, you've been indoctrinated with an idea that is not my original idea. So you merely have a concept of who you think you are.
Okay.
But when you begin to open your heart up to my word and you allow my Holy Spirit to live in you,
yes.
My purpose for you is first to understand your identity. Say identity.
Identity.
Your purpose. Say purpose.
Purpose.
Vision. Say vision.
Vision.
And direction. Say it.
Direction.
When you understand God's precept, you begin to understand your identity, your purpose, your vision, and direction in life. Because God's precept is the key to who we truly are.
Okay, I'm not going to say that. Let's keep going. Mm-hmm. Verse
11. We pray that you may be strengthened and invigorated with all power according to his glorious might to attain every kind of endurance and patience with joy. Verse 12. Giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to share in the inheritance of the saints, God's people in light. Say inheritance.
Inheritance.
Say it again.
Inheritance.
Punch your neighbor in the jaw and say, no, don't do that. Don't do that. Don't do it. I made myself laugh too much on that. So here we are. The Bible is bringing up this word called inheritance. How many of you all know that the only way a person can receive an inheritance is that somebody has to die?
Yes.
That's the only way an inheritance is legal. Somebody has to die.
Absolutely.
And if you can prove who you are, you're entitled to receive every benefit that was left behind on your behalf, an inheritance. Jesus came to the earth, did everything that he did, and then he died. Now put the car in park right there.
Okay.
Who knows John 3:16?
Okay.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believed in him would not perish and have everlasting life. Who is the God of this world? Satan. The Bible tells us Satan is the God of this world. Let's go back to John 3:16. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world. Go back and do your history on that word world.
Uh-huh.
The word world is a Greek word, cosmos. K-O-S-M-O-S, not C-O-S. K-O-S. If you look up the definition of that word world, it's translated established order. Structured system. So if you take that definition and put it in John 3:16, it says, for God so loved his established order, his structured system, that he gave his only begotten Son,
yes,
that whosoever would believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. Why would God put that clause in there for us? It's because he's saying, look, I want your mind to open up to understand this truth. I did not allow my Son to only come to die for people, but I did not give up on everything I created.
Amen.
God did not give up on the earth. God did not give up on how the earth functions. He did not give up on systems.
No.
Man gave up his dominion in the garden. We got to understand this. Adam and Eve did not lose heaven. I'm pausing. That might be a shocker for some people. Adam and Eve did not lose heaven. Where did God create Adam and then pull Eve out? Where? On
earth.
So Adam and Eve were never established in heaven physically. They were established in a physical planet called Earth. They gave up and lost their dominion.
Yes.
And when they gave up their dominion, Satan said, I'm going to take that same authority and I'm going to create a whole new system in this earth.
Yes, he did.
And sin would actually give us an altered identity. Sin would redefine our perception of ourselves. Oh, I didn't talk about this in the first service, but I'm going to talk about it right now. Perception, say perception.
Perception.
Now, don't repeat it because I loved it on this side. I didn't even hear them. Now, y'all only say this word, perspective. Perception?
Perception.
Perception.
Boy, y'all good. Perception has everything to do with our senses. What we see, what we hear, smell, taste, touch. That's our senses, perception. Perspective is the child of perception. In other words, our perceptual experiences cause us to have the perspective, the outlook on life that we do. What if, from a child, all of your perceptual experiences, what you heard growing up, what you saw, the food that you smelled, the sensations that you, what if all those things were wrong? That means that your personal identity and how you see other people has been messed up. And you have called something truth in your life that is based on the wrong identity. And so before sin came into the garden, Adam and Eve's perception, sensual experiences were got with God, came from God's precept. Original idea. That's what precept means. Original idea of your original identity. And so their outlook on life was very different from how we look at life.
Amen.
Post-sin. And so now God has to actually put this plan into place where he says, I'm going to go ahead and put this in your constitution. We'll put it subsection chapter 3. Article 16. And we'll call it John. And he said, this is only necessary because of what sin has done. He wants us to go beyond only thinking that Jesus is only focused on getting us saved. Jesus, the finished work of Jesus Christ is what allows us to be reintroduced to the Father sinless. But Jesus is ultimate plan was for us to understand our original identity. He didn't want us to just stay at the cross all day long begging him for stuff. He said, you got to understand, my sons and daughters, you have an inheritance that was lost in the wrong identity. Here's one of the effects of the wrong identity. We get saved and then we want Jesus to hurry up and come back and get us out of here through the rapture. When did Jesus ever tell us to pray for the rapture to hurry up and come?
Come on.
As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us the perfect prayer. When they said, we don't know what to pray. They said, well, when you pray, pray for this. Pray for what God wants, his original idea, his precept. Not your concept. The reason why you don't know what to pray is because you got the wrong concept. You got the wrong idea. That's why you're confused. He said, but I'm going to tell you, here's the original idea. Pray, our Father who is not in heaven or who is not on earth. I meant to twist that up on purpose because I want us to think. Our Father who is not on earth. I know what it says. Our Father who art in heaven. But our Father who is not on earth. Holy is your name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done. Where? On
earth.
Just like it is how? I'm pausing. I want you to really think about that. It is not about asking God to hurry up and come back and just wipe out this planet. He said that you have an inheritance. We have an inheritance. What is the inheritance? Earth.
Yes. Yes.
God did not change his mind about what he started before sin kicked in. The earth has always been God's taste. John 3:16, for God so loved his established order that he allowed his son to die for the established order and the people. So what God is saying to Satan and to sin and our jacked up identity, I'm after the whole shebang. I don't want you to feel like you need an escape plan anymore. I want you to wake up and recognize that you are my sons and daughters. Now, here's the beautiful thing about that. You're not just a son or a daughter. You're a king.
King. That's good.
The Bible has to back this up, so let me go ahead and put some scripture in there. The Bible calls Jesus the King of and the Lord of. How many people know, going back to this again, the only way you can receive an inheritance is that somebody has to die.
Okay.
Was Jesus the king?
Yes.
Who did he hand the inheritance over when he died?
Every one of us.
He gave it to us.
Amen.
The inheritance is this. Recognize your dominion mandate. Everybody stand up on your feet. You got to catch this. You got to catch this.
All right.
On the count of three, everybody take a step. Don't step forward. You're going to kick the chair and then somebody's going to fall. But just lift your right foot up and stomp down on the count of three. One, two, three. Do you realize the power of your step?
Okay.
Adam and Eve had to take dominion over the earth, but they couldn't do it unless they... I'm pausing. I'm going to stop on purpose because you got to think about this. This is not a religious game. This is our life.
Come on.
And when you catch the revelation that you were created to dominate,
yes.
You will no longer live your Christian life the way you've been living it since you got born again.
Glory to God. Come on.
Stay standing. We are under attack. The Bible tells us that the kingdom suffers violence and the violent take it by force.
Amen.
John the Baptist was preaching kingdom.
Yes.
Before Jesus took his rightful place. He was preaching kingdom. He was saying repent.
Yes.
For the what?
Kingdom of God is at hand.
John the Baptist was preaching kingdom before Jesus spoke a word about kingdom publicly. Jesus was so convinced that the kingdom message is everything that his very first recorded sermon, Jesus said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. I do a lot of pausing because I want you to think. You understand that every step that you take is a promise from God?
Yes.
He told Abraham, I'm going to make your seed as vast as the stars and the sand on the sea. And he told him, everywhere that you take a step will be yours.
Blessed.
North, south, east, west, it don't matter. Northeast,
yes.
Southwest, it doesn't
yes.
matter. He said, everywhere that you walk, you
yes.
take a step.
Yes.
He said, I can make that promise because of what I already put in you.
Already yours.
Let's go back to glory. God had already put his glory in Abraham when Abraham was a pagan worship, idol worship in person.
See the glory.
He just didn't understand who he was.
Hallelujah.
But when God showed up and began to open his mind up
yes.
to understand
yes.
that there's a lot more to
yes.
you than what your ancestors
glory
have taught
God.
You, all of a sudden, Abraham got a clue, and he said, if I'm going to walk this thing out, I got to walk it out by faith. But I'm walking it out with understanding that every time I take a step, wherever I land,
yes.
I'm taking authority.
That's it.
I'm taking
That's
territory.
It. That's it.
My loved ones
Come
got
on,
to get saved.
Come
My
on.
Lifestyle got to turn around.
Come on.
Every enemy's
Come
got
on.
To shut up. I got to see those that are lost saved. You are a powerful individual.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Stay standing. Stay standing. Your mind has got to shift. Somebody shout, shift.
Shift.
Your mind has got to shift today. You don't have a spirit because you
are spirit.
You have a dominion kingdom mandate that is about to be activated in your life today. You were not born to play patty cake with Satan. You were not born to fit into the next religious clique. You were born again to make a difference, to be a world changer, and watch the kingdom of darkness fall. I'm going to close in the next 5 minutes. Stay standing. I want you to grab the hand of the person next to you. Good God Almighty, I feel something.
Hallelujah.
I feel something.
Hallelujah.
I want you to say this out loud. If you knew.
If you knew.
Look at your neighbor. Say, if you knew.
If you knew.
Who I really was. You give me $100 right now. I want you to understand this. The hand that you're holding right now, God is so cold in how he does everything. He does not make counterfeits. The hand that you're holding, their fingerprint reveals the glory of God. Because there's not another design on the planet that can copy what your fingerprint is. Only God can be that ingenious.
Yes.
You know what that means? That means that you are rare.
Peculiar people.
And the last time I checked, when you discover that something is rare,
right,
that means its value cannot be labeled. Its value is through the roof. You can't get enough diamonds to compare. You can't get enough gold.
No.
There's no material on the planet that can actually imitate what you're worth.
Wow, come on.
You are worth so much that the glory that is on the inside of you is extremely heavy that if you start to let it leak out, people around you that you know lives are messed up, they're going to begin to discover, I want what you got. I don't want to go back. I want to go forward because I love what I'm seeing, baby. I'm telling you right. Where's he at? That young man who came out of rehab.
In the white shirt.
What's his name?
Jonathan,
come here, man. Come here, baby. Come here. That's what I want you to keep holding that hand. I know it feels uncomfortable. That's all right. You ain't going to die. When I was sitting there and Pastor was talking about just a snippet of your journey, I saw in my head this. Stand next to me. Stay in step with me. You know what that step is? You know how powerful that step is? It's so powerful that it's sober. Take another step. And you took another step. There was a day when you couldn't take two steps and be sober. But the power of God revealing his identity in you is saying you will never go back to that old life again. Take another step. And when you make your mind up that you will never be used again, that you will never be the victim again, you're going to have new ideas, you're going to have dreams, and you're going to begin to live a powerful life that will make a difference in so many other people's lives. That thing will never own you again in Jesus' name. Amen? Come on, brother. That's right. That's right. That's right. That's right. Two more minutes. And so what I want to say to you right now, hold the hands again. Y'all tripping. Learn to never let go of that which is incomparable and you cannot place a value on. Learn to get past your uncomfortableness with holding rarity. Because today you're truly holding someone's hand that when they exit the planet, there will never be another one like that. And you get the privilege of actually having this moment of enjoying that rare individual right now. And when you begin to recognize the intrinsic value in each other, you will begin to sharpen iron. As iron sharpens iron, you're going to begin to encourage each other in spiritual songs and hymns, and you're going to influence each other to manifest each other's glory for the glory of God. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pray for a gully washer Holy Ghost move in just the next moment while you're holding hands with that person. I don't know what's going to happen. Some of y'all might act a fool and fall out. Some of y'all might start, I don't know. You might just stand there and look like deer in the headlight. I don't know. But I do know this. The Bible says if any two touch and agree. Let me go back and say that again. Our Constitution says, our rights and our privileges,
yes.
If any two,
yes.
Touch and agree,
yes.
With anything in the earth, it shall be established. Here's a question. Was Adam made from the dirt of the earth?
Yes.
Are you a seed from Adam?
Yes.
So you're standing holding a dirt body. And in that dirt body is the spirit of the living God. So that means that you're touching and agreeing. And since our Constitution says that whatever two people touch and agree on, it's going to happen. Yes. Baby, I believe kingdom citizens are about to be ignited in this place today. Ooh, Jesus. Join me in faith.
Yes.
Father God in heaven.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus Christ, the King and Lord. According to the Constitution you've given us, let your power begin to flow through hand to hand, and may it be igniting kingdom authority like the world has never seen before. And when these people go back to their various destinations, everything that was unfamiliar with you will have to die. And I thank you for the great awakening in this place today. Let your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Somebody shout amen.
Amen.
Give him praise. Woo, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Wow. God Almighty.
Wow. Now I know why the devil was so mad. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let me just share something with you real quick that you would understand his kingdom principles and how they really line up to us living a powerful life. He taught be accountable. He taught be productive. And he taught be powerful. Okay? What you have to understand is in those three principles is a numeric flow. First, we have to be accountable. What do you mean, preacher? You have to be accountable to who you are. You have to step up and say, I am the I am. I am a child of the Most High God. You have to be accountable. Let me do it like this. He said inheritance. When my mom died 20 years ago, she left me an inheritance. The inheritance was mine. When I went to get the inheritance, they said, wait. Before you can have this money, Miss Jennifer, you have to prove that you are who you are. I had to show my identity. I had to be identified as who I am. And when I was identified in the world's face of who I am, I was had access to my inheritance. I could get my money. Once I got my money, I could make right choices to be productive. And as I make right choices in being productive, watch this, I had an opportunity to be powerful. If we are going to be accountable, meaning I am going to know who I am and walk in who I am, I'm going to be accountable to who God says I am, then I move into a place of being productive. But when you start walking in the way of being productive, you have to make a decision that in my productivity, I'm going to operate in God's way. So when you begin to operate in God's way, you move into principle number 3, which is power. Because God says, if you do it my way, if you say it what I said, if you do what I did, if you do what I told you to do, then there's power because the onus of success now falls on me. Now let me line that up with some more Bible and we're going to go eat. The Bible says, watch this, because remember I said it had numerical flow. The Bible says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. The way, the truth, and the life. The way means I got to be accountable. I got to be walking Jesus' way. I got to be accountable first. Accountable to what? God's way. So now I am the way. And the Bible says when you have understood and are accountable to the way, he says next, the truth. He says, so now I'm accountable to who I am, the way. Next, he says, Jesus says, then I'm the truth. So that means productivity comes through the truth. The truth is the word. So now the way, accountable. Lord, I'm going your way, so I'm held accountable. I'm accountable to your way. I know who I am. Now I go to the truth, which is the word. From accountability to truth. That's how I'm productive, because I'm operating in the truth. Now watch this. Here we go. The last thing he said was, be powerful. Remember what Jesus said. Jesus says, I'm the way, accountable. I'm the truth. Now take my word. Then he says, then you have life. Well, how is that the power, Pastor? Because Jesus said, don't get it twisted. I came that you will have life and life more abundantly. There's the power. There's the power. There's the power. Because the more abundant I am, the more ability I have to share with my kids, to share with my neighbor. Abundant what, Jesus? Abundant love. Abundant joy, abundant peace, come on, abundant peace, come on, abundant understanding, abundant healing, abundant resources. Now you just became powerful because you have the ability to sow into other lives. Woo. Come on, somebody. That's so powerful. Because how many times have you heard the truth, the way, and the life, but you didn't see it, and I have to walk in this in progression. I got to walk the way, accountable. Then I have to know and get the truth. And then from the truth, I experience real life. What kind of life? Life more abundantly. Come on, man. That's so good right there. That's so good. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's go to scripture of giving, because we believe that we start service with worship and we end with worship. Giving is worship. Giving is a heart issue. No way, because we don't beg at Mount Zion. The preacher just said we got to be accountable. I just taught you about the truth. Look at what the Bible says. Look at what the Bible says. The Bible says, you shall give to him who, Jesus, the kingdom of God, freely, watch this, and your heart shall not be begrudging. So that means Jesus is concerned not just with your giving, but your heart. How are you giving to Jesus? He's concerned about our heart. Jesus don't care about what's in our hand. He wants to know what's in our heart. You can't outgive God anyway. But this is what I want you to see, because we're talking about being accountable, then being productive, and then being powerful. So are we accountable with our resources? Are we productive with our resources? And then our resources become powerful. Watch the powerful in the scripture, how they become powerful. God says if you give freely and your heart is right, watch this. Here's the powerful. He says, because for this, the Lord your God will bless you in all work and in all undertaking. Now, we miss that because we, woman of God, we think about this word blessed and we really don't understand the power in what he just said, the power he's releasing. Because blessed means the uncanny, innate ability to survive, thrive, and sustain in any adversity. That's blessed. And that's power. That means no matter what you do, Satan, I'm going to be all right. Do you understand that kind of blessing? That's power. That's the kind of blessing that God says he's releasing when your heart is right. Come on, somebody. Now, before we go to altar call, I just want to ask you one question. It's time to give. Come on up, ushers. Come on up, ushers.
May your struggles keep you near the cross.
May your troubles
show that you need God.
May your battles
in the way they should. May your bad days prove that God is good. May your whole life prove that God is good. May your struggles
keep you near the cross. May your troubles show that you need God.
May your bad days prove that God is good. May your whole life prove that God is good. May your struggles keep you near the cross. And may your troubles show that you need God. May your battles end the way they should. May your bad days prove that God is good. May your whole life prove that God is good. May your struggles keep you near the cross.
May your troubles
show that you need God.
May your battles
show the way they should. May your bad days prove that God is.
Chapter 5 talks about
about the fruit of the Spirit.
Hallelujah.
One of those fruits is peace. The decision that you have to make, you're guaranteed to make the right decision because you're guaranteed to trust one of the fruits of the Spirit, which is peace. So when you look at your decision that you have to make, look for the fruit of peace in your heart. And you'll know exactly what your decision has to be. So I don't know who that's for, but there's a decision that you're having to make. I don't know if it's a business deal, if it's from a relationship issue, but the decision can be made with confidence because you have the Holy Spirit, which is the seal of God in your life. You have the promise to access
Hallelujah.
The peace regarding your decision. So operate in that, move in that, and you're going to make the right decision, and wonderful things are about to happen in your life. So this is the last time I'm going to ask you to stand, so stand up on your feet. A lot of faith has been activated today, and you're going to go home and you won't be able to be comfortable with your Christianity the way you used to be, because now you're moving into kingdom citizenship and kingdom authority. If you're here today and you've never named Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, this is your moment. This is your opportunity to come and receive Jesus for the first time in your life.
Yes, Lord.
To seal your salvation. The beautiful thing about that is there's more to it than just salvation. You get to enter into an abundance, super abundant life, and you get to grow forward with wonderful hopes and dreams. So if that's you and you need salvation today, I want you to come to the front, and you can come over here to the left side, and they will pray a prayer of salvation for you if that's you. Here's the other thing. If you're here and you have any need to touch and agree with a brother or sister in prayer, on the count of three, come up here and stand with somebody so you can touch and agree about whatever it is the Lord's put on your heart. One, two, three.
May your whole life prove that God is good.
I hear the Lord say that we have been speaking about activation.
That's a powerful word. I get it. But I hear the Lord saying to somebody today, few people, that I want you to recommit yourself to me today. Recommit yourself to me today. That you've been walking in a dry season. It's been a dry season. But I hear the Lord saying, I need you to recommit yourself to me today. Jesus says, if you tell them I'm your friend, I'm going to tell God you my friend. Today I just want to offer you an opportunity. Why don't you come and relight the fire? Why don't you come and let us pour fresh oil and fresh anointing on you? There's somebody in here today. You want to reconnect with Jesus. You've been distant. You feel like you don't hear him. I want you to come. Come now. Come now. Come now. That's it. That's it. Hallelujah. I know I'm talking to you. It's two more. Come on. Come on, I know that you're here. Now, come on. And you just want to reconnect your life to Jesus. Come on. Come on. Come on. Today's the day. I know it was two. Come on. This is the one, and that's two. Come on, woman of God, right here. Amen. The Holy Spirit is always true to his word. That's it.
Come on. God is good. May your whole life prove. God is good. May your struggles keep you near the cross. May your troubles show that you need God. And may your battles in the way they should. And may your battles true.
Listen, come on downstairs this morning. That'd be all right, woman of God. Let me pray over the
room.
That'd be all right. Father, we come right now in Jesus' name. We ask you, Father, that you bless the food. Lord, bless the hands that have prepared it. Lord, bless the lips that are going to consume it. But Lord God, you said in your word that man can't live on bread alone, but from every word that proceeded out of your mouth. So I'm asking God that the word we heard today, that we would be able to decipher it. You know what I mean? You do, Miss Rose. How we go back and say, what part of that was for me? What does that mean? Lord, I'm asking that we are able to decipher and to store this word in our body as nutrition and protein that we would continue to grow. Lord, I thank you for a powerful word and a move of God today in activation. We pray this in Jesus' name. Everybody said? Okay, listen, guys. When you get downstairs, go right in line. Food's ready. Food's ready.
God who's in the way they should. May your bad days.
We know we fall for not the devil, man.
May your hope.